Oh, wait, as soon as Alan shows up. Thanks for doing this, my lord.
The Subcommittee on Energy and Mineral Resources will come to order. The subcommittee is meeting today to hear testimony on the fundamental role of safe seismic surveying in outer continental shelf energy exploration and development. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at hearings are limited to the chairman and the ranking member and the vice chairman and a designee of the ranking member. This will allow us to hear from our witnesses sooner and help members keep to their schedules. Therefore, I ask unanimous consent that all other members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted to the subcommittee clerk by 5 p.m. today. Hearing no objection, so ordered. I now recognize myself for my opening statement. Our hearing this morning is about the pivotal role that geophysics plays in understanding the subsurface of our nation's outer continental shelf. Whether it is through gravity, magnetic, or seismic methods, this science combines math and physics to look deep into the Earth's surface. This technology has grown by leaps and bounds over the past few decades, providing a more accurate understanding of our offshore resources. There is no doubt that this scientific endeavor aids in the discovery of hydrocarbons, but seismic surveying also aids in dredging and beach nourishment projects, as well as other offshore construction projects. It has also helped to determine where to locate offshore wind turbines. Most recently, the United States Geological Survey, paired with the National Science Foundation and the Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory of Columbia University, to conduct an offshore seismic surveying along the Atlantic seaboard from New York to Virginia to study sediment thickness in our exclusive economic zone. The data collected will aid in the study of potential submarine landslides capable of generating dangerous tsunamis. The research vessel that conducted this seismic surveying deployed a 36 air gun seismic array with a tow depth of 9 meters, emitting sound pulses every 20 to 24 seconds as the boat moved at roughly 4.5 knots. This is all according to their submitted application. This partnering of federal agencies with research institutions to foster a more hands-on approach to STEM education should be something we as a nation encourage. All that said, this operation is very similar to the 8 proposed seismic surveys that are currently awaiting permits from the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management and the National Marine Fisheries Service. The only difference is the 8 companies I described want to collect data to determine potential hydrocarbon resources, but they can't because they are still awaiting permits from the federal government. The science behind this geophysical activity is the same. A pulse of sound energy is issued from a seismic array that is towed behind a seismic vessel. That sound reflects off of subsurface rock layers and returns to the surface to be collected by hydrophones and later processed. Entities that conduct offshore seismic surveying are also required to employ various mitigation techniques to reduce the impacts that these activities might have on marine mammals, such as employing marine mammal observers who watch and monitor for protected species, and passive acoustic monitoring to detect marine mammals in the vicinity of the vessel. Operations must shut down in the event that an animal is detected in the area, and operations must slowly ramp up once the animal has departed. Despite all these mitigation techniques, there are still several radical environmental groups who would rather stand in the way of scientific research than allow for a better understanding of our outer continental shelf seabed, whether it is for hazard preparedness or for energy resource potential. Yet the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management's chief environmental officer has stated that there is no evidence of noise from seismic activities adversely affecting marine animal populations or even coastal communities. Director Hopper has agreed with this statement when she testified before this committee earlier this year. Additionally, we will hear testimony that supports this finding from Dr. Robert Gisner, who holds a PhD in biology and decades of experience in the field of marine bioacoustics, including work for the Chief of Naval Operations Environmental Command at the Pentagon. The USGS research vessel that launched out of Brooklyn, New York last August applied for their seismic permit in March of 2014. They received their permit or incidental harassment authorization from the National Marine Fisheries Service 5 months later. The eight companies awaiting permits from both BOEM and NFS have been waiting for over a year with no progress. Two of these companies are present today to testify, and I thank them for making the trip to Washington to share their experiences with this process. The bottom line is that seismic surveying can be conducted safely, causing no harm to marine mammals. So why should it take so long to get a permit? I have yet to hear a reasonable answer to this question, but I hope our witnesses today can help provide some clarity. I now recognize the ranking member for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I can certainly appreciate the tremendous amount of interest in this issue from both sides. We're talking about the first step towards new offshore drilling in the United States' eastern seaboard for the first time in decades. Incidentally, at the same time where we've already become the number one producer of oil in the world, and that understandably causes emotions to run high. Personally, I don't believe that moving to offshore drilling in the Atlantic is necessary or wise, particularly when you factor in the impacts of industrialization on the pristine shoreline, the potential for a catastrophic spill, and the inevitability of smaller spills, which we know will happen as just occurred on the California Central Coast. Mr. Chairman, I know you know this. We're all very familiar with your position on this area. This is because this is not the first hearing that we've had on seismic exploration on the Atlantic OCS. We've had one on the exact same topic just last January. But here is the real tragedy and dereliction of committee duty, in my opinion. This year, our hearings have focused almost exclusively on fossil fuel extraction. Outside of budget hearings, six of our eight subcommittee hearings, including this one, have been about oil and gas development. Seven out of nine, if you count tomorrow's on fracking. And what about the other two? They have been about helium and mining. Not a single hearing has focused on the development of renewable energy, despite our bipartisan support for this issue. To the extent that we do talk about renewable energy in this committee, it's either tangential to the actual purpose of the hearing, as in this one, or it's largely an attempt to embarrass the administration, as was the case with the Oversight Subcommittee hearing a few weeks ago on renewable energy bonding. This hearing today is the perfect opportunity to start the conversation in this committee on how to develop the renewable resources of our offshore lands. With vast wind energy potential but minimal oil and gas resources, the Atlantic Outer Continental Shelf could be used as a model region to demonstrate a commitment to an energy policy that doesn't only favor the oil and gas industry. By just developing the wind energy areas that are currently designated by BOEM, the Atlantic OCS could produce, and I repeat, and I say this clearly, 16,000 megawatts of electricity, enough to power roughly 4.8 million homes. These areas could be developed with minimal long-term impacts to marine ecosystems and with low risk to local fishing and tourism industries. In contrast, even if all the technically recoverable oil and gas were extracted from the Atlantic OCS, it would only meet U.S. consumption needs for less than 1 year. And developing these fossil fuel resources would pose enormous risks to the environment and the coastal tourism and fishing economies while jeopardizing the welfare of future generations. Even the exploration procedure for oil and gas are more damaging than those for offshore wind. While some downplay the impacts of seismic surveys for oil and gas by saying they're very short duration sound pulses, much like ultrasounds used for pregnant mothers, that comparison is a false comparison and about as meaningful as saying that a charcoal barbecue on the 4th of July is the same as a nuclear bomb because they both create light and heat. An ultrasound is designed to penetrate at most about 1 foot of soft tissue. Seismic tests are designed to penetrate tens of thousands of feet of solid bedrock. As you might expect, the intensity of sound needed for oil and gas service is much louder, hundreds of times that of a jet engine. These sound blasts occur about every 10 seconds for days on end, can disrupt important marine ecology. The economics, the environmental risks, the energy potential all point to wind as the obvious choice for development in the Atlantic. As members of the Natural Resources Committee, it's our duty to make sure that we are developing our natural resources responsibly and a balanced measure. This means not just focusing on depletable resources that we can remove from our lands, but also recognize the sustainable resources that we can harness less invasively. For all these reasons, I respectfully ask our chairman to hold a hearing on the development of renewable resources on public lands before the end of the year. Thank you, and I yield back.
Okay, I'd like to introduce our witnesses. We have Mr. Jim White, president of ARCX, Inc., Dr. Robert Gisner, director of Marine Environment, Science, and Biology for the International Association of Geophysical Contractors, Ms. Abigail Ross Hopper, Director of the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, Dr. Douglas Novacek, Repass Rogers, Chair of Marine Conservation Technology at Duke University Marine Laboratory, and Mr. Richie Miller, President of Spectrum Geo, Inc. Let me remind our witnesses that under our committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. When you begin, the lights on the witness table will turn green. After 4 minutes, the yellow light will come on. Your time will have expired when the red light comes on, and I would ask you to complete your statement at that point. The chair now recognizes Mr. White to testify.
Thank you. Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Member Lowenthal, and members of the subcommittee, good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today to testify at this oversight hearing regarding the fundamental role of safe seismic surveying in the OCS energy exploration and development, and specifically, its role in the Atlantic. My name is Jim White, and I am president of ARCX, a non-seismic geophysical company. We provide proprietary multi-client geophysical data and integrated workflows to oil and gas exploration companies and production companies in the United States and worldwide. We are headquartered in Cambridge, the UK, with offices in Australia and Houston. ARCX is a member of the International Association of Geophysical Contractors, the Trade Association for the Global Geophysical Industry, and the International Airborne Geophysics Safety Association. We are pleased that Congress continues to look into this important matter that could provide key info to develop energy independence, but it has been over a year since the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management released its record of decision authorizing permitting of geophysical activities on the Atlantic OCS, and the time is now for us to move forward and take the first step in determining the resource potential by allowing geophysical surveys to get underway. Seismic and other geophysical surveys have been safely conducted in the U.S. and around the globe for over 50 years. They are the first critical step to better understanding the resource base and providing policymakers and regulators the information they need to make informed decisions. In fact, it is equally important to understand that these surveys can determine areas that are and are not likely to have recoverable oil and gas resources. Geophysical surveying that would take place in the Atlantic is not only seismic, which utilizes an acoustic energy source, but non-seismic as well. Let me first give a description of my company and our technology. ARCX acquires non-seismic geophysical data using full tensor gravity gradiometry, or FTG, and licenses these products to oil and gas companies. FTG surveys measure minute variations in the Earth's gravitational field and are acquired from a fixed-wing aircraft with flight paths and flight heights that are generally the same as those planes that fly banners up and down the Atlantic coastline. Incidentally, recent FTG surveys have been successfully completed in the offshore areas of Honduras and Greenland. I must also note that the FTG data is a complement to seismic imaging data and does not replace the much-needed seismic process. Our data is used in conjunction with seismic data to provide an improved interpretation and can also help to effectively place seismic programs in frontier areas for better understanding of the resource potential. ARCX applied for our permit in June of last year. Since that time, we have done our part to properly inform and educate various state and federal agencies through the numerous meetings and presentations. We have completed every public and environmental review, state consistency determination, and condition necessary to obtain the permit. While this process took more than a year, I am pleased to announce today that every agency has approved and signed off, and we have now received our permit from BOEM. Thank you, Director Hopper. Our plane is sitting in North Carolina and is ready to commence the first geophysical survey in the Atlantic in over 30 years. When Boeing released its draft five-year plan for offshore oil and gas leasing in January of this year, Secretary Jewell stated an interest and need in learning more about the resource potential in the Atlantic OCS. The ARCX survey alone will not be enough to do that. Modern geophysical imaging is the only feasible technology available to make an updated and accurate evaluation. Geologists and geophysicists believe that the Atlantic could have much more abundant oil and gas resources than previously believed based on the hydrocarbon productivity of the Atlantic margin in areas like West Africa, Brazil, and Nova Scotia. The industry's array of new tools can better help us understand the potential resource by combining the data from ARCX FTG surveys while existing subsurface knowledge and future seismic data. Geologists can improve the confidence in their geologic model and more accurately assess and locate oil and gas. While I am relieved by the news that I share today that ARCX successfully navigated the permitting process in the Atlantic, my colleagues in the geophysical industry and at this table are still awaiting their permits in a process that seems to increase in complexity and length. It should not take a congressional hearing or an act of Congress for these permits to be processed based on the thorough administrative and scientific record to date, which concludes there is no evidence that sound from marine geophysical activities is harmful to marine life. The geophysical industry operates in every region of the world, and experience shows that geophysical survey activities, tourism, fisheries, and marine life can and do coexist successfully. Now is the time for the nation to take the necessary steps toward continued energy security and independence by allowing seismic and non-seismic geophysical surveys to begin in the Mid and South Atlantic OCS. We must equip our decision makers with the necessary information they need to make sound decisions regarding the future of oil and gas leasing in the Atlantic. Only modern geophysical surveys can provide such data. We appreciate the opportunity to testify and thank you for your time today.
All right, thank you. And I want to thank each of the witnesses for being here this morning. The chair now recognizes Dr. Gisner to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Dr. Bob Gisner. I am the Director of Marine Environmental Science and Biology for the International Association of Geophysical Contractors. However, I'm here today to speak to you as a scientist, including my most recent role as a member of the Sound and Marine Life Joint Industry Program, a program of independent scientific research funded by members of the offshore energy industry. Thank you for this opportunity to provide some information about the sound generated by marine seismic surveys and its environmental effects. First, a little bit on my background. I have a PhD in biology from the University of California. I have been actively engaged in cutting-edge research on marine bioacoustics for over 40 years. In 1993, I was invited to lead a newly formed research program at the Office of Naval Research on the effects of sonar and other sound sources on marine life, a program that to this day continues to lead the world in research on this subject. From 2010 until my retirement in 2014, I worked with the Chief of Naval Operations Environmental Command at the Pentagon to implement a policy and environmental compliance plan based on the scientific knowledge generated by the ONR research program. A legacy of responsible environmental stewardship without loss of Navy mission readiness, of which I am very proud and for which I was awarded the Navy Meritorious Civilian Service Award. My service to our nation and its marine mammal environmental stewardship goals also includes a term of service between 2006 and 2010 as the Scientific Program Director of the U.S. Marine Mammal Commission. Following my retirement from federal service in 2014, I was invited to assist IAGC with a similar program of research and application of the science to responsible environmental compliance practices, including participation in the Joint Industry Program of Research. As a newcomer to this industry, my perspectives may be of help to others who are also new to the geophysical industry, its technologies and practices. And I will start by stating categorically and confidently that there is at present no scientific support for statements that seismic sound kills or injures animals, causes them to beach themselves, or disrupts their behavior to the extent that it affects the health and well-being of the individuals or the populations of which they are part. This does not mean that we will not continue to actively search for possible undetected risks through our support of independent third-party research, or that we will reduce our diligence in monitoring, mitigation, and documentation of our activities and their environmental effects. It does mean that speculations about what could, what might, or what may potentially occur will be subjected to similarly high standards of scientific verification and validation. First, some information about seismic sound sources, or air guns. The term gun can be misleading. There is no explosion or firing of air. The compressed air is released in a bubble around the source through several ports. This can best be visualized through a video on the IAGC website. The link is provided in the supporting materials accompanying this testimony. The air inside the source is compressed to the same pressure as in a scuba tank or a household pressure washer, and when released, the expanding bubble produces sound. The largest sources hold a volume equivalent to a 1 or 2 liter soda bottle. And a full array would have a compressed volume equivalent to a mini fridge or maybe something close to a full-size refrigerator. This is not a sound source equivalent to 100,000 jet engines or an atom bomb. Any claims that seismic sound kills, injures, or causes the beaching of marine mammals, fish, or other species are speculation and are not supported by the scientific evidence. Recent research has in fact shown that the threshold at which some small hearing loss might start to occur would be on the order of 210 decibels of total energy, or SEL. This is equivalent to the cumulative sound energy from 10 consecutive seismic air pulses at a distance of less than 100 yards. It's a degree of exposure that is all but impossible to achieve. Current regulatory thresholds are 180 dB, and thus overestimating my risk by several orders of magnitude, and the associated mitigation shutdown range of 500 meters is also correspondingly overprotective. Much has been made of the estimate in the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management's Atlantic Programmatic Environmental Impact Statement of as many as 138,000 level A potentially injurious takes under the Marine Mammal Protection Act. Using a more realistic risk criterion, based on recent peer-reviewed research and taking into account standard monitoring and mitigation practices, the best available science estimate of risk is essentially zero. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The chair now recognizes Director Hopper to testify.
Good morning, thank you. Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Member Beyer, and members of the subcommittee, I'm pleased to appear before you today to discuss the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management's oversight of geological and geophysical surveys on the Outer Continental Shelf. Such surveys support BOEM's mission to ensure the responsible development of conventional and renewable offshore energy and marine mineral resources while protecting the environment. As you've heard, geological and geophysical data is critically important to understanding the bathymetry of the ocean floor, as well as the vast area underneath. There are numerous technologies that can be employed to gather this data, which is used for a variety of purposes, including hydrocarbon exploration and production, aiding in siting renewable energy structures by characterizing the ocean floor, locating potential sand and gravel resources for coastal restoration projects, identifying possible seafloor or shallow depth geologic hazards, and locating potential archaeological resource and potential hard bottom habitats that should be avoided. One common method of procuring this data is with seismic surveys. Those surveys use sound waves sent through the ocean floor to map the subsurface. From 1966 to 1988, two-dimensional seismic data were acquired in areas of the Atlantic outer continental shelf. This data, acquired over 30 years ago, has been eclipsed by new acquisition techniques using more advanced instrumentation, computer capability, and technology. Industry seismic surveys in the Atlantic have not been conducted since the 1980s, primarily because of the federal moratorium on oil and gas activities off the Atlantic coast, which expired in 2008. Additionally, BOEM decided not to begin reviewing permit applications until the programmatic environmental impact statement was completed and a decision made on its alternatives. That record of decision, or the ROD, as we call it, for Atlantic GNG activities was issued by BOEM last July of 2014. It established stringent protective measures and safeguards consistent with allowing survey activity while reducing or eliminating impacts on the environment and marine life. Protected measures include, but are not limited to, vessel strike avoidance, special closure areas to protect the main migratory route for the highly endangered North Atlantic right whale, consideration of geographic separation of simultaneous seismic air gun surveys, and passive acoustic monitoring to supplement visual observers and improve detection of marine mammals prior to and during seismic surveys. While the ROD did not authorize any GNG activities, it established a framework for additional mandatory environmental reviews for site-specific actions and identified broadly applicable measures governing any future GNG activities in the region. The ROD also identified mitigation measures that may be supplemented by additional requirements in individual permits or other authorizations as the reviews move forward. GNG surveys are not used exclusively for oil and gas exploration. Seismic surveys, which include geologic coring, are also helpful in identifying sand used for restorations of our nation's beaches and barrier islands following severe weather events and for protecting coasts and wetlands from erosion. Seismic and geologic coring surveys also provide information that is vital to the siting and development of offshore renewable energy facilities. As of this date, 9 companies have submitted 11 conventional energy GNG permit applications in the Atlantic OCS. Currently, 8 permit applications remain under review, as 2 have been withdrawn and 1 permit has been issued. Of those remaining 8, 7 applications include deep penetration seismic, and 1 application is for a high-resolution, multi-beam and sub-bottom profiler survey to collect seafloor and shallow subsurface information. Before each permit can be issued, BOEM conducts careful environmental analysis to ensure protection of the marine ecosystem. These permit applications are also subject to coastal consistency review determinations pursuant to the Coastal Zone Management Act. Of the 8 active permits, 6 applications have completed that CZMA review process. 1 application did not require consistency review, and 5 have concluded it. Further, applicants for seismic surveys need to secure additional authorizations from the National Marine Fisheries Service under the Marine Mammal Protection Act and the Endangered Species Act. Of those 8 active permits, 6 have applied for an incidental harassment permit with NIMS. And BOEM has announced it will not issue permits until those processes are complete, since our permits are limited to 1 year. So with that, I conclude, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes Dr. Nowacek to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and members of the committee for the invitation to speak to you today. My name is Douglas Nowacek. I'm a distinguished professor at Duke University, and I've been studying bioacoustics of marine animals, primarily marine mammals, for almost 20 years. I'd just like to start by saying it's almost impossible to underestimate the importance of sound to ocean animals. They rely on this much more than they do sight, chemical, or other senses that they might have. Sound travels 5 times faster and much more efficiently through water than it does through air, and signals can travel like those frequencies contained in seismic survey pulses can travel for tens, hundreds, even thousands of miles through the ocean. I'd like to make just a couple points about wildlife and noise. A recent paper, I'll read the title, A Synthesis of 2 Decades of Research Documenting the Effects of Noise on Wildlife. The some 300 papers reviewed in this one paper, 2/3 of them are on birds and marine mammals, and they contain conclusions like noise can and does impact individual fitness, which I would note are the things that are made up of population changes and consequences, and the structure of ecological communities. And I'll also note that 50% of the studies reported in this that reported biological responses did so at levels below 125 decibels, which is orders and orders of magnitude below the level that Dr. Gisner just quoted. So noise affects wildlife. We know that. It's established. It's 20 years of research that have told us this on various levels. Seismic surveys produce noise, and not just for the 100 milliseconds around the pulse duration. If I could have the first slide, please. The pulses are short, but they expand out in time and space, and what I'd like folks to glean from this one figure is that the noise levels in between the pulses, which are shown by the red rings, the 2 whales pictured in there, one is 10 miles away and one is 50 miles away, the sound levels reaching that whale at 50 miles away are easily above the levels that have been shown to impact bowhead whales in the Arctic. And I think it's very important to keep in mind that it's not just the pulses. The ambient noise levels in the area are raised by orders of magnitude, if I could have the next slide, around the time of the pulses. Those 3 traces, dark blue, light blue, and orange, show 2.5, 5, and 10 seconds after a pulse, and the ambient level is shown in red. And so the dB scale, again, is logarithmic, and so we are looking at orders of magnitude of increase in ambient noise in and around the seismic survey, during the seismic survey. So noise impacts wildlife. Seismic surveys produce noise. So this simple fact, taken with the numerous studies documenting specific individual impacts from seismic surveys, leave us really no alternative but to conclude that seismic survey noise impacts marine animals. And I'm very comfortable making that statement as a scientist with 20 years of experience. We need to think larger about the impacts of this noise, and that brings me to the environmental impact statement prepared by Dr. Hopper and her agency. And this environmental impact statement, the agency did a monumental task in putting this together. The regulations governing the amount of exposure really hamstrung them in some ways, and there's a fundamental mismatch between the spatial and temporal impact or the influence of air gun signals and the analysis conducted by BOEM. The analysis is predicated on a much smaller area of effect, NIMSA's grossly outdated 160 dB threshold, and assumes that the effect is only from the impulse. This ambient noise comes back again to be a lesson. So I would suggest that we redo those analyses, and whether those analyses are done or not, I also would recommend that we revisit the mitigation measures. And there are three simple ones. Reduce the amount of sound energy introduced into the water, and we had we've had lots of ideas on this. First of which could be constraining the seismic survey area to the area of oil and gas, potential oil and gas leasing. There's no reason for seismic surveys 3 miles off the coast or 5 miles off the coast when there won't be any leases until we're at 50 miles. We need to protect vulnerable species and habitats like right whales and the Atlantic canyons and the Hatteras Point. These are areas too special to develop. We also need to establish a comprehensive monitoring plan for these animals. If this activity is to go ahead, we need to make sure we can detect any effects. Next, I would like to end with a very short story. It's entitled "The Dirt on the Road." It must have been a strange sight to see city workers spreading dirt on the road. The location of that dirt was the 6th and Chestnut Streets in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The building in front of which the dirt was being spread was the venerable old Pennsylvania State House, which you would know as Independence Hall, where the Declaration of Independence had been debated and signed. The date on which that dirt was being scattered in front of that building was May 14, 1787. Philadelphia, and the entire nation for that matter, waited anxiously with their eyes on that building. Why? Because on that day, some of America's best men were slated to convene and save the freedom won by the Revolution in drafting the U.S. Constitution. So, why the dirt? Quiet. It was there to muffle the distracting noise of horse hooves and the clatter of carriage over hard cobblestones. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes Mr. Miller to testify.
Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Member Beyer, members of the subcommittee, good morning. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today to discuss the fundamental role of safe seismic surveying in the OCS energy exploration and development, and the need for America to access its offshore oil and gas resources. I am president of Spectrum Geo, Inc., a company engaged in acquiring non-exclusive seismic data, processing it, and licensing these products to oil and gas companies. The Spectrum Group is built on the company's reputation as a reliable seismic service provider and serves a global clientele. We are pleased that the subcommittee is holding this hearing today. It could not be timelier. Since testifying at previous subcommittee hearings on the role of seismic in helping the U.S. discover new resources in the Atlantic Outer Continental Shelf, Spectrum Geo and some of our industry colleagues have embarked on the process of obtaining the necessary permits and approvals to acquire modern seismic data in the mid and South Atlantic. The process has been wrought with delays and uncertainty. Of particular concern is the process for NIMS issuance of IHAs under the Marine Mammal Protection Act, which is critical to the permitting of exploration and development activity. Last summer, the Interior Department approved a process for geophysical survey firms to submit applications for seismic acquisition in the mid and South Atlantic. A few companies have filed applications with NIMS to obtain IHAs, which are necessary for BOEM to issue permits for Atlantic seismic surveys. This NIMS process is still ongoing, nearly 1 year after the applications were submitted. We have now been told the earliest an IHA will be approved is late December, meaning the earliest a program can commence will be in spring of 2016. Spectrum first met with NIMS to discuss our plans to acquire seismic data in December of 2013. At that time, we understood that we would complete the process in the spring and could begin acquiring seismic this summer. That timeline has since slipped considerably until the end of 2015, and our application has still not been deemed complete. We also understand that NIMS has added a new unprecedented public review period to the process in addition to the existing public comment period. In contrast to our recently completed experience with the Coastal Zone Management Act consistency reviews, which reflected an efficient and predictable process at NOAA, we are becoming increasingly frustrated that the IHA process is taking far longer than expected. These delays could ultimately jeopardize the timely acquisition of seismic data. Federally funded seismic acquisition surveys take place off of the East Coast virtually every year without IHA delays, with several such recent and ongoing Atlantic seismic surveys securing IHAs in 5 to 7 months. None of these IHAs underwent a public review period in advance of the statutorily required 30-day public comment period, as is now expected to be required for the Atlantic oil and gas survey applications. It is important to note that other countries permit seismic operations much more efficiently than the U.S. is doing for the Atlantic. For example, Mexico just recently opened up its OCS for non-Mexican explorers and to new seismic acquisition, and Spectrum thereafter worked with 3 federal agencies to secure a permit within 4 months. And now there are 8 seismic vessels and 5 companies operating in different areas of Mexican Gulf of Mexico in a safe and efficient manner. Elsewhere, oil and gas seismic acquisition has been taking place offshore the Canadian Atlantic during the past 6 summer seasons without incident to marine life. Also, oil and gas seismic operations have been underway in the Bahamas, Cuba, and Alaska over the last few years. The U.S. Atlantic thus lacks an effective system and schedule for the issuance of IHAs for seismic acquisition. This system needs to be fixed. Over the past 2.5 years, we have spent almost $1 million in pursuit of this permit. Spectrum and other companies continue to spend time and money on this broken process, and we may never get the permits necessary to inform the public and decision makers on the Atlantic's true resource potential. Furthermore, modern seismic imaging provides greater certainty for explorers. It increases the likelihood that exploratory wells will successfully tap hydrocarbons and helps us to avoid drilling for oil and gas in areas where we won't likely be successful. It also reduces the number of wells that needs to be drilled in a given area, thus reducing the overall footprint for exploration. For these reasons, and to better understand the extent of resources that exist in areas like the Atlantic OCS, and for the betterment of our national security and economic well-being, we need modern seismic data. In turn, we need a system that allows us to acquire that data. Let's allow science and modern technology to help us discover what resources we have. We owe it to ourselves. Thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Okay, I thank the panel for their testimony. Reminding the members that Committee Rule 3D imposes a 5-minute limit on questions, the chair will now recognize members for any questions they might want to ask the witnesses. And I'll begin with myself, then we'll go to the ranking member and go on from there. Director Hopper, what is the permit process that USGS/NSF had to go through in order to conduct their 2D seismic survey last summer that was referenced earlier?
I will share my best understanding of the process since BOEM was not involved in that. We have no role in the permitting of that. My understanding is that they had to go to NIMS for an IHA, an incidental harassment authorization, and that was the permit they needed.
And why didn't BOEM have a role in that?
We don't have regulatory oversight over those scientific. We do for renewable energy, oil and gas exploration, and marine minerals.
Okay. Mr. Miller, could you repeat for us my understanding is that the USGS-NSF survey got their IHA, incidental harassment authorization, in 5 months from NIMS. How long have you been waiting for an IHA from NIMS?
We filed our IHA in August, I think it was August 10th of last year.
Okay, so a year?
Almost 12 months.
Okay. And by the way, we did, for the audience, we did ask NIMS to come. We asked them 10 days to 2 weeks ago. They said they didn't have time to produce a witness. So that was their response. Director Hopper, Is there any possibility, and I have to admit I have a suspicion here, and I'll voice my suspicion, that some of these permits are being held up, whether it's BOEM or NMFS, because there's the possibility of significant hydrocarbon resources off of the Atlantic coast that some people don't want to be discovered?
Sir, I can only speak to my agency, to BOEM, and I can assure you that at BOEM we believe strongly in the importance of G&G permits to understand that resource in the Atlantic. I think we have historically, for the last 5 or so years, been clear that understanding the resources in the Atlantic are an important part of that frontier strategy. We put it in our last, in the current 5-year plan. As you know, we have a proposed sale in the next 5-year plan. So I would be happy to sort of lay out the timeline we have gone through that includes a fair amount of time spent with the Coastal Zone Management Act. Those states, this is not a G&G permits for oil and gas, were not a listed activity. So BOEM met with every one of those states in August, immediately after our ROD came out. We walked them through that process. They filed with the CZMA office at NOAA permission to review the permits on this panel. NOAA gave them that permission in November, I believe. The permittees coordinated with the CZMA offices. Those states gave us BOEM and the NOAA office back their conditions on the permits. So that has just happened in the last month, a couple of months, depending on when the permittees got their information. BOEM has also, we did 8 outreach meetings in 7 states up and down the Atlantic coast to talk with citizens and elected officials and fisheries management folks and CZMA offices about the process that happened in late March and early and April. And we've done we're doing our own environmental assessment. So we have walked through a pretty rigorous process, but as I said, we are married to the issuance of the IHA in order to issue the final G&G permits.
How can this very complicated process, which you have said is a safe process, you've stated that, and I think you're accurate when you stated that. Why is it taking so long, and how can we simplify it?
I think the challenge is that this kind of these surveys trigger many of the federal statutes, the Marine Mammal Protection Act, the Endangered Species Act, the Fisheries Act, and so each of the regulatory agencies need to ensure compliance with those, and so I think that's what takes a bit of time to do.
Dr. Gisner, let me ask you, you categorically stated that this is a safe process regarding its effect on marine mammals. Do you agree with what Dr. Nowacek said in his testimony in that regard?
No, I don't, sir. And the reason it has to do with the issue of biological significance. There is no doubt that seismic survey, as through many natural sounds, get the attention of animals, alter their behavior in some way. That's a normal part of life. We're talking about when that disturbance becomes something that is more than they can accommodate in their normal course of life, and we have not seen that yet. We will continue to look for it, but we haven't seen it yet.
Okay, thank you, and I'll now recognize Representative Beyer for his questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks all of you to come and be before us today. Dr. Nowacek, your expertise is in marine mammals, but it seems likely that the effects of seismic surveys is probably not limited to whales and dolphins. Fisheries are a very important driver in the economy in the Atlantic communities. In the mid-Atlantic, for example, the commercial seafood industry supports 37,000 jobs, generates over $1 billion in total economic impacts, with similar numbers for the South Atlantic region. So in fact, both the Mid-Atlantic and South Atlantic Fishery Management Council have written letters to BOEM voicing their opposition to seismic surveys in the Atlantic OCS over their concerns of impacts on fisheries. And Mr. Chairman, I'd love to submit these letters from these two fishery councils for the record.
If there's no objection, so ordered.
Thank you. So Dr. Nowacek, can you discuss what the potential impacts of seismic surveys are on fish?
Yes, sir, absolutely. There are numerous studies documenting effects of different kinds of noise on fish, from shipping noise to air gun type noise. There are fewer studies than we have for marine mammals, though nonetheless conclusive, including ones that isolate noise as the only variable in affecting some of the reproductive and vital functions of the lives of fishes. Many fishes use low frequency for things like mating aggregations and territory defense and mate attraction. Again, the very same frequencies that are contained in shipping, in seismic survey pulses. I would like to say that, you know, noise to a certain extent is noise, and I think we need to talk about it on that level, and noise from all these sources can do the same things. Furthermore, there's widespread scientific concern for fish with gas bladders. And gas bladders, also called swim bladders, not all fish have them, but they're a vital organ for these animals to control their buoyancy in the water column. And as an air-filled cavity inside of a marine animal, they are particularly susceptible to large changes in pressure. When we study deep-sea fish, for example, we have to be very careful bringing them to the surface, and I say we, the larger we, because those gas bladders can erupt and cause the death of the fish. Seismic survey pulses are a pulse of energy. It's very, very simply stated. So we worry about those gas bladders.
Thank you, Dr. Nowicek. Let me move on.
Sure.
It's just fascinating to listen to this because I end up with two, you know, very different perspectives. So Dr. Hopper, is Mr. Bill Brown still the chief environmental officer of BOEM?
Yes, he is.
Okay. So he said, and at least I'm quoting from, I think, Dr. Grissner's testimony, quote, "There's been no documented scientific evidence of noise from seismic activities adversely affecting marine animal populations or coastal communities. This technology has been used for more than 30 years around the world, and no known detrimental impact to marine animal populations or to commercial fishing." Director Hopper, do you agree with your chief environmental scientist's conclusion, this statement?
I certainly do, yes.
And Dr. Nowicek, how do you reconcile the 3 or 4 pages of footnotes you have of studies that disagree with the chief environmental officer? How does a layman put these together?
Right. No, it's a very good question. I think the Dr. Brown's statement is very narrowly focused on a particular sound source and a particular class of animals. And what I would say is that populations are made up of individuals. And to assess population-level impacts, there are several metrics we can measure. One is we can count them. And you think that might be easy for animals the size of this room, but it's not. We rely on things like building models, and into those models we put things like vital rates, and those are how successful is an animal at reproducing, how well does it forage, does it find food for itself. We have a study right here I could read to you about sperm whales reducing their foraging effort in the Gulf of Mexico in the presence of seismic surveys. And so when an animal feeds less, down the line that results in potential threats to that individual and thus the population. And just a quick analogy, if I may. If you showed up for work one day and it was extremely loud in the office, noise causes fatigue, it causes stress, it causes lots of things in mammals. And if you left the office that day and were driving home and were distracted by that fatigue and so on and got into an accident and it killed you, could we trace that loss of a life and the reproductive effort back to the noise? It's a very difficult thing to link, but we rely on those models of population fitness and population consequences to inform us about the effect of any disturbance, whether it's noise or any other. And we have those documented individual fitness issues.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Representative Duncan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Hobart, does William Brown still work for you?
Yes, sir, he does.
What's his role? What's his position?
He is the chief environmental officer.
Right.
Mr. Byer was,
Chief environmental officer for BOEM. So on your website, August 22nd, 2014, he has a letter there, dear reader. He's got an impressive resume, by the way. I looked at it on his Wikipedia page, but he says this, "As a scientist who has spent a good part of my career working in non-governmental environmental organizations and in industry, I understand and appreciate advocacy. At the same time, I believe that everyone benefits by getting the facts right." So you scroll down to the next page, the science behind the decision. On your website, it says, "To date, there has been no documented scientific evidence of noise from air guns used in geological and geophysical GNG seismic activities adversely affecting marine animal populations or coastal communities. The technology has been used for more than 30 years around the world, and it's still used in U.S. waters off the Gulf of Mexico with no non-detrimental impact to marine mammal populations or commercial fishing. So that's on your website. You testified back in March, and I ask you on the record, have there been any verifiable instances of marine mammals being killed or harmed due to seismic G&G activity? You said no. I referenced the website at that point in time, but permits are still being held up for G&G activity. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to enter into the record a letter from Richard Hudson, member of Congress, and myself, about the delay of the IHA process, the incidental harassment authorizations.
If there's no objection, so ordered.
Thank you. It is our understanding, according to this letter, that National Marine Fisheries plans to undergo an unprecedented and unnecessary additional review period on the applications this summer before incidental harassment authorizations are proposed for additional public comment. These things are lasting months, 10 months, 11 months now. That's for the record. So I disagree with the need for IHAs based on Mr. Brown's testimony, or his written letter rather, and based on your testimony, what the website says. But if I look at the basic Marine Mammals Protection Act process for the issuing of permits, it says you contact National Marine Fisheries Service if activity may result in a harassment of marine mammals. And then the next step, can a take be avoided through modification or protective measures? First off, you've got to say that a take is going to happen. Based on the facts that's presented here in your, on your website, there hadn't been a verifiable take in the history of seismic activity. So I don't see that there's a take in process. You ought to issue the permits. But if you don't, if you think there might be a take and it can't be avoided, then you have to go through this long, convoluted process to get a permit. Now, this is ridiculous. So why are we requiring incidental harassment authorizations for G&G activity when we can't prove there has been any marine mammal harassment, deaths, maiming, or anything like that? In fact, Mr. Brown says, hey, we're going to deal with the facts, but Oceana says they have the facts in this brochure. They say these are the facts. I'm going to believe a chief environmental policy guy for you then before I believe Oceana. But let's talk about the facts. You're requiring an IHA for G&G activity. At the same time, IHA equivalents are having to be issued by U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for wind and solar production. Let me tell you about the facts. It is a fact that wind and solar kills hundreds of thousands of birds, many of them protected birds under the Endangered Species Act, under the Golden Bald Eagle Protection Act, under the Migratory Bird Act, Treaty Act. Those are protected species that are killed by wind and solar that's being supported, if you heard the opening statements, by the ranking member. Let's do more wind and solar. Let's kill more birds, more protected birds and migratory waterfowl is what I'm hearing, because those are the facts. But let's hold up G&G activity over some pseudoscience that says that marine mammals are going to be killed or maimed, and let's go through a 10, 11, 12 month, how long it's going to take to issue an incidental harassment authorization when there's no verifiable instance of harassment or death or maiming of a marine mammal. I hope you get where I'm coming from. We're issuing take permits for wind and solar every day. And we know that birds are being killed, either fried on solar arrays or being knocked out of the air by wind turbines. Golden bald eagles, condors, other migratory birds, but not a verifiable instance of a marine mammal being hurt by seismic. It's time to get off of square one and move on for G&G activity off the Atlantic coast so that our state, South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, Georgia, can all play in part of this energy renaissance, meeting the needs of this country. That is the right thing. So I would urge BOEM and Marine Mammals Protection and every other agency and sub-agency and every act to move forward. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the leniency, and I yield back.
Thank you, Representative Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to go to Director Hopper. As you know, the department issued the record of decision for Atlantic Geological and Geophysical Acquisition in June of 2014. When do you expect the permits to be granted so seismic data acquisition can begin? Can you give us a time frame as to when that's going to happen?
Sure. So the ROD for the Atlantic G&G issued in the Federal Register July 22nd of 2014. I'm happy to report on Friday, July 10th of 2015, we issued the first G&G permit to ARCX, represented all the way to my right. There are currently 8 other seismic permits pending. As I was explaining, we do a portion of it. As Representative Duncan is aware, that NIMS does the IHA portion of it. So we have continued to make good progress with the Coastal Zone Management Act consistency. Almost all of those are complete now. We do coordination with the Department of Defense. Obviously, the ocean is a pretty busy place. It's important to coordinate with them. We do coordination with NASA. All of those have been undergoing and are sort of on track. And so our process is working forward. You heard the timeline, I think, that NIMS has put out from Mr. Miller about the IHA permits. So when the IHA permits are ready to go, it's my job as the head of BOEM to make sure that we are absolutely ready to go.
How will the development and acquisition of this data then feed into the 5-year leasing process? My concern is that with the process as it exists today with potential delays, is how it affects that process. And if there's a delay or incompleteness of the data as it's collected on seismic, how will it affect the 2017 to 2022 OCS leasing program decision making for OCS on the Atlantic coast?
Right. So the sale, the Atlantic sale that's currently in the 5-year plan is scheduled for 2021. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't anticipate that timeline would change dramatically. So I think that there's ample time to get the information at the geophysical and geotechnical surveys done before that, have the data analyzed so that at the lease sale stage, we'll have the information necessary.
Very good. Thank you. Mr. White, I wanted to ask you about the perspective historically of collecting seismic data. As you know, there's been a seismic survey done in the Atlantic OCS in at least 30 years. Can you give us an overview about how the technology has improved and what you expect seismic surveys today to discover in relation to the potential resources off the OCS, let's say off Virginia, Maryland, Carolinas?
Sure. And just for the record, the company that I run is a non-seismic geophysical company.
Yes.
There is no energy source, but I do have acute knowledge of the seismic business because I've been in the business for over 37 years. So I have a lot of knowledge as it pertains to seismic exploration specific to your inquiries about the East Coast. It has been over 30 years. Seismic technology has developed over the years, and we've applied that new technology in areas around the globe. Specifically, Gulf of Mexico is a place I'd like to point out. And I think it's important to understand when we look at the impact of seismic exploration on marine mammal life, it's very easy to look at what we've been successful at in areas like the Gulf of Mexico. And again, if you talk about the fisheries group in the Gulf of Mexico, some of the best fishing in the world is right there in the Gulf of Mexico. Some of the best seafood that you get comes out of the Gulf of Mexico. So obviously the impact of seismic exploration, which has been very expansive in that particular region, has been negligible to the marine mammal life. So our technology, just to make sure you understand it, it's passive. There is no energy source. We fly an airplane at roughly 150 to 200 meters above the surface, and we just fly basically a pattern, and we image minute variations in the Earth's gravitational field in the subsurface. What's interesting about our technology is it provides the explorationists with a good understanding of where they might pinpoint seismic. We cannot replace seismic. You're not going to drill a well on FTG data alone. You need seismic to complement that. And that's an important point to understand.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. White. I appreciate your comment there that some of the best seafood in the United States comes from the Gulf. I'm going to give respect to my Gulf brethren, but some of the best seafood in the United States also comes from Virginia. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Would we agree with that?
Kudos for being second best.
Okay, Representative Fleming.
Thank you. You know, I hearing this testimony makes me think about a saying we have in Louisiana, and that is
penny wise and pound foolish. We heard my good friend from South Carolina talk about how we sacrifice endangered species all for the effort of so-called alternative energy sources, and yet we debate this issue about acoustic imaging that we yet cannot find a problem with. The other thing that I think about is our colleagues on the other side of the aisle want us to restrict leasing offshore for drilling. But the companies tell us that there's two problems with that. Number one, they have to drill hopefully where the oil actually is, and to do that they have to know where it is, and that's where acoustics come in. Otherwise they waste a lot of money, which drives up the cost of energy, and then secondly they disrupt the seafloor, which is should be unnecessary and bad for the ecology. The other thing that I would mention as a physician is that we've actually been using acoustic techniques on mammals for decades, human beings. We do it every day. Hundreds of thousands of people every day get ultrasounds, including fetuses, and we are yet to find a problem with that. So I would ask Ms. Hopper, how long has seismic testing been in use in the Gulf of Mexico?
I would say at least 50 years, sir.
50 years. Have there been any documented cases of harm to marine life during that time?
Not to my knowledge, sir.
Okay. When was the last time a seismic permit was issued?
In the Gulf?
Yes.
Probably last week. I'm not sure.
Okay. My notes say that the last time, well, has there been a private company issued prior to perhaps just this last week? I think you mentioned one is coming up, but before that time.
In the Atlantic or in
yes.
the Gulf of Mexico?
Either one.
In the Atlantic, prior to last Friday's issuance, it was 1988.
Okay.
And in the Gulf, it's a regular course of business, so I actually don't keep track of when we issue them.
Okay.
But we frequently.
Right. So why are research institutions receiving permits but not private companies?
So they have different regulatory requirements. BOEM has regulatory authority over renewable energy, sort of on the Outer Continental Shelf, renewable energy, oil and gas, conventional oil and gas exploration, and marine minerals. And so for those geological and geophysical surveys, we have processes to approve those. The academic, the scientific studies are not, don't fall under our jurisdiction. They do, my understanding is they do need to get an incidental harassment IHA assessment authorization from NIMFS, and so that goes through a different process.
Okay, so it's different processes or the explanation for the difference in the permits. Mr. Miller, can you briefly describe a few of the mitigation techniques that are required by the programmatic EIS in the Atlantic and how they differ from those used in the Gulf?
Yes, sir. There's a three or four different mitigation factors listed in the PIS. One of them is a ramp-up timing. It's 60 minutes in the Gulf of Mexico. It's 30 minutes in the, 30 in the Gulf, 60 minutes on the East Coast. I think it's a very random change. It's probably no science behind it at all. It's just let's double it and see how that works. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really affect us in any way. There's also a source vessels, or the sources have to be 40 kilometers apart or separated in the Gulf of Mexico. It's 30 in the East Coast, which is probably another random number. Let's just cut it down to 10. That does affect us a little bit if there's more than one vessel around. The big one is, we're required to have a PAM, which is a passive acoustic monitoring system on board. That's also required right now in the Gulf of Mexico. But the big one is dolphins. And we've been acquiring data with dolphins since more than 50 years ago. And when I worked offshore in the late 80s, we watched the dolphins play in the bow wake every day. In the eastern U.S., we have to shut down for dolphins, which will have a significant impact on financial impact on these surveys.
So there's differences between the Atlantic and the Gulf, but for unexplainable reasons.
That's 100% correct.
Inconsistency. Okay, well, my time is up, and I yield back. Thank you.
Representative Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome back, and Ms. Hopper, and I want to thank all the witnesses for being here today. Appreciate your testimony. Ms. Hopper, I'm from Louisiana, and certainly, along with Dr. Fleming, very concerned about some of the testimony today in regard to the suggestion that the use of seismic technologies to help inform decisions for exploration and production causes an adverse impact to the Gulf of Mexico and the health of the Gulf of Mexico species. Louisiana is the top commercial fishery state in the continental United States. We're one of the top recreational fishing destinations as well. I'm struggling with understanding how there appears to be different treatment in the East Coast as it compares to the Gulf of Mexico. And I'm trying to understand, is there some reason why, is there some belief that the East Coast is more important or that its marine resources are more important than those of the Gulf of Mexico, and some lesson learned there that I'm not aware of?
Sure. No, sir. There's no one is not more important than the other, but they have different animals in them. So the gentlemen on either side of me are the experts on the animals, but the kind of easily understood answer is that there are different neighborhoods. There are different species in the Gulf of Mexico than there are on the Atlantic. And so when BOEM followed the federal law and consulted with NMFS, the National Marine Fisheries Service, under the Endangered Species Act, NMFS proposed some mitigation measures, similar kinds of measures, as Mr. Miller said, exclusion zones, acoustic monitoring, ramp up times, distance. Once you see marine mammals, you have to cut them off. But the application of those techniques was tailored to the particular animals that live in the Atlantic as opposed to those that live in the Gulf.
Thank you. So are those mitigation measures or are they obstacles? I mean, because the permits aren't truly being issued to conduct seismic activities, though.
I would call them mitigation measures, sir.
But mitigation measures would suggest that they're actually overcomable or something that you could actually address while looking at the amount of time that has passed with no permits being issued. It suggests that it does perhaps fit more in an obstacle category. William Brown, who I believe Congressman Denham referenced earlier, Duncan referenced earlier, chief environmental officer for BOEM. When some of these allegations were brought forth, he's quoted as saying that the assertions were wildly exaggerated and not supported by evidence. He went on to say that there are orders of magnitude more noise from vessel traffic as compared to seismic surveys. Are you aware of the government requiring mitigation measures for vessels?
I believe there's a fairly active mitigation measures for the Navy, sir, and I'm not sure about the
Coast Guard. But vessel, I believe the Navy may pertain more to its research on sonar as opposed to actual vessel traffic. The sonar has to do with anti-submarine warfare activities. Mr. Miller, we're certainly very familiar with seismic activity at home in Louisiana. With all of the activities we have there, top offshore energy production state in the United States, in fact, more production than the other five states combined that do offshore activity. The idea behind seismic is that you are trying to make a more informed decision in terms of where you do your E&P activities. Can you talk a little bit about sort of the balance on making more informed activities based upon the outcome of seismic information as opposed to going out there and effectively just poking holes all around and taking a fundamentally different approach to conservation?
I mean, a good example of that is that in the Gulf of Mexico, in the last 15 years, the resource base has increased five times. And that is a lot of that is to do with 3D seismic imaging. The E&Ps have been able to use that to drill less holes, which is less impact. But we expect the same thing off the Atlantic. The information that's there now is 30 years old. We get new data, we get new information. We expect the resource base to significantly increase off the Atlantic.
Mr. White, would you care to comment on that?
Absolutely. What's most important, I think, to look at is just success rates of wells that were drilled. Prior to 3D seismic, that success rate was probably in the neighborhood of 30%. And now, because of 3D seismic, you're looking upwards of 60 to 70% success rate. So that means that you've eliminated, unnecessarily, 30% of wells that probably don't need to be drilled. And that's an important point when you look at it from an environmental assessment, from that perspective. And as we've, I think a few of us on the panel have alluded to, you know, when we image the subsurface, we do find areas that are not prospective for exploration. Okay, and so seismic and non-seismic imaging can provide that extra information to the geoscientists to make sure that they don't explore in areas that are not necessarily conducive for oil and gas exploration. And there was a comment made earlier about the fact that we don't need to image in areas that are not up for exploration. That's not true. We need the regional subsurface geology picture to understand specifically those areas that are targeted for exploration, as well as the areas that are not targeted for exploration.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I just think it's really critical to make the point that, number one, that the own chief environmental officer of BOEM is saying that vessel traffic causes noises that are orders of magnitude larger than that of seismic activities, and yet there are no mitigation associated with simply driving vessels across the Atlantic, and I think that's a noteworthy point. Lastly, Congressman Whitman, I just certainly appreciate the efforts of Virginia to catch up with Louisiana on the seafood, and I wish you well in that. And next time you have a crab cake from Virginia or Maryland with Louisiana blue crab in it, you could perhaps think about that.
Well, all I can say is if NIMS had to issue an IHA for every vessel going across the surface, there would be no boat traffic of any kind. Okay, Representative Heiss.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate you calling the hearing today. Obviously, this is a critically important issue that impacts our energy independence, and I want to thank our witnesses for being here as well. And really, I would just like to share the frustration of many of my colleagues today. You know, it's been over 6 years since this administration has announced a regulatory process for allowing seismic surveys, and yet still we have not had a single permit that's been issued. And I find this totally unacceptable. Mr. Geisner, let me just begin with you. When dealing with seismic surveying compared to, say, offshore construction activities, be it something like dredging or other construction activities, what is the difference? Say the Port of Long Beach or my home state, Georgia, the Port of Savannah, what is the difference between, comparatively speaking, the seismic surveying versus other construction activities?
In some ways, it's an apples and oranges comparison, sir, but I'll give you some examples. The sound from seismic surveys is quite loud. Everyone agrees on that. The sound is a tenth of a second long. There's a 10-second interval in between, so 1% of the time is filled with energy. Professor Novacek pointed out that as the sound propagates, there may be reverberation or echoes, but those are considerably quieter than the initial pulse. On the other hand, things like dredging, commercial shipping was brought up, those are continuous sounds. They're not as loud as seismic, but they're 24/7, 365. Ports are noisy places. A lot's going on there, construction as well as shipping. The global seismic survey fleet is something like, and Mr. Miller may be able to speak more clearly on this, but I think it's about 50, 60 vessels active. The commercial shipping fleet in the world is over 10,000 vessels. They're in operation all the time. They can't afford to sit idle. So the total amount of acoustic energy put into the ocean by shipping, we've heard the word orders of magnitude used a lot, but it's orders of magnitude more than you're getting from seismic. And so, yes, your Port of Savannah is a pretty noisy place to be, but it's 99% shipping.
Yeah, and with that, the Port of Savannah, of course, we've had multiple environmental studies, and the impact on aquatic life has never been an issue with all of that. And I'm grateful, quite frankly, that this discussion today was not an issue for the Port of Savannah, as it is now the hub
of so much activity in the southeast, and I hope this will be a lesson for the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management so that we can get to the 3.3 billion barrels of oil and the 30-plus trillion cubic feet of natural gas. Let me go to Mr. White, if I can. Of course, Georgia's tourism and fishing industry is very important. Your company does a lot of seismic and magnetic surveys, that type of thing. How do these coexist, the fishing industry and the surveys? Is there a problem with them coexisting?
Again, I point to areas around the globe that we've been successful to coexist. And unfortunately, it's been since the mid to late 80s that we've done any geophysical exploration off the eastern seaboard. So we can't utilize that maybe as an example, but we can use other areas around the globe that we've been acquiring geophysical data. And the opportunity to acquire that data and coexist with marine mammal life is obviously very prevalent. So I don't think there's an issue as we look at it from that perspective.
So they can coexist, obviously. Let me conclude, Ms. Hopper, with you. Based on the answers, not only for my questions, but my colleagues, I'm still confused, frankly, why this administration has failed to approve even one seismic permit to the private sector, when even your own office, your chief environmental officer, stated last August that there is no evidence of the seismic activities adversely affecting the aquatic life. So yes or no, just a simple question. Would you be willing, and your office be willing, to support the permitting of seismic surveys at the National Marine Fisheries Service since leases in the Atlantic have been deemed a priority in the last 5 years?
I'm sorry, sir. Could you ask me that question again? Would I be willing to support
Yes, to start supporting permitting.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Sure. I yield back.
This is such a great discussion. Let's have a second round of questions. Okay. Everyone's here. You're doing a great job of responding. We really appreciate it. There's just a handful of us who are left, but I know there are still some burning questions. And I'm going to defer my time and go straight to the next person in line, Representative Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to go to Dr. Gissner. Earlier, Dr. Nowacek talked about the impact, the potential impact of sound both on marine mammals and fish. I want to kind of put that in perspective. We've heard a lot about vessel noise, but one thing that hasn't been mentioned that is actually, as far as energy intensity, greater than just the vessel noise, and that is sound put out by specific instruments meant to find fish, better known as fish finders, depth sounders. And there's a new technology there, compressed high-intensity radar pulse, better known as chirp sounders. They put out multiple frequencies. They're about 10 to 50 times more energy intensive than previous depth sounders. They're also directed energy, so they direct energy in a very, very specific cone down to fish, marine mammals, who get intersected with that energy all the time. It's amazing to me that we have hundreds of thousands of those devices out there. Yet, we know in energy intensity, as far as fish getting pulsed and the impact on that, that in accumulation, that's much greater than any acoustic sounding that would go on with seismic surveys. Can you give us a perspective about that source of energy too and its impact on marine mammals and fish?
Thank you, sir. It's a very interesting question, at least to people like me. Of course, all these sonar technologies, they've become ubiquitous. I don't know that there's a private or a commercial ship now that doesn't possess two or three depth sounders for safety of navigation and fish finders and so on. And of course, in fishing, those devices are intended to directly insonify the fish. Their effect on marine mammals, when there is an effect, it seems to be a dinner bell effect. They hear the sound, that means fish to them, and here they come. They're going to get a free meal. The complexities of this in terms of the ecology of the sound and whether the animals react or not could take us hours, and I know I would lose all of you. But some fish, like cod and herring, that hear very well, fishermen have noted that using those fish finders can actually disrupt the school's fish, and sometimes they turn their fish finders off. So it's proving to be a technology that's kind of a two-edged sword. It's helpful in finding the fish, but it may not be very helpful in harvesting those fish. So a lot to learn there.
Could you put that in perspective as far as orders of magnitude about the exposure of these fish and marine mammals to these sources of sound energy versus what they would be exposed to cumulatively through seismic surveys? I think we just need a perspective there, because it's being said that these seismic surveys are in this massive way harmful to marine mammals, harmful to fish, but it does that out of context to all the other sources of sound energy that these fish and marine mammals are exposed to. So can you kind of put that in perspective for us so we understand the magnitude of what seismic surveys would provide to fish and marine mammals versus what they're exposed to every day, including what we heard about the other sources of noise in the marine environment?
Yes, sir, I'll do my best. Of course, there are many more vessels that are going to have fish-finding sonars on them or navigational sonars than there are seismic vessels. So just in terms of probability of encounter, marine mammals and fish are going to encounter those noise sources much more frequently than seismic. Most of those sources are about as loud as a seismic survey or a little bit less, but their chirp rate, the rate at which that sound occurs, is usually more frequent. The duration of the sound itself may be a little bit longer than a seismic pulse. And they're at different frequencies. Some are at very high frequencies that only a few species of marine mammals could hear. Others are at lower frequencies that fish or marine mammals could hear. So it depends on the frequency at which the thing is operated, the pitch, how many of them there are out there in use, and how those things are being used. If they're directly targeting fish, which is probably areas where there's a lot of marine mammals, then they're going to encounter those animals a lot more frequently than seismic, which is looking for something completely different.
Thank you, Dr. Gissner. Another thing, too, if I remember my fishery science courses from my undergraduate days, fish do have tails. That caudal fin, I think, does propel them in a way that they can actually move away from things that they don't like. So I think that also probably has a little bit of biological effect on how fish react to sound. So regardless of the magnitude of how we want to express seismic surveys as being a risk, I think fish are endeared by Mother Nature with some pretty ingenious ways to make sure that if it's something that's going to affect them, they can get out of the way. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. Representative Beyer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Gissner, I'm still trying to reconcile all the different science that's been presented here this morning. In Dr. Novacek's testimony, I'm quoting from the written part, he said that firing the standard air gun array deployed behind a seismic survey vessel generates approximately 250 to 260 decibels of sound. And these are levels approximate the epicenter of a grenade blast would easily cause the rupture of human eardrum. He goes on to talk about the efficiency of sound in water and that the seismic air guns can be heard greater than 2,500 miles from the source. In your testimony, you were talking about only 210 decibels of total energy. And we know, 10 decibels is a doubling, so that's a huge number difference. And that is equivalent to a cumulative sound array from 10 consecutive seismic pulses at a distance of less than 100 yards from even the largest arrays. How do you reconcile these two very different presentations of the amount of noise that comes from the seismic gun?
Actually, sir, it's fairly easy. The 250 to 260 decibel number is what's called a nominal source level, and it's the contribution of multiple seismic elements to create the beam of sound that looks downward into the geology. It's called nominal because that number is never achieved. A nominal 250 to 260 dB source level is an imaginary level, as if that whole array of sources was one single point generating energy. I use an analogy in my written testimony of looking up at a chandelier or listening to an orchestra. From a distance, it sounds like one entity, or it looks like one entity, and it seems quite bright. But as you get closer, and you single out a single instrument in the orchestra or a single light in the chandelier, it's actually much less loud, much less bright. The same thing happens with a seismic array. If you moved closer and closer to the seismic array, you're at 160, 180, 200, 210, you get to 220, and it never gets louder because the separate sources now have not come together to contribute to that one coherent beam of sound downward. So that's a problem right there. The numbers being tossed around, extremely high numbers, do not, in fact, exist. They're at a shorthand, an imaginary number for analyzing the data.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. So let me move on because we have limited time.
Sure.
Dr. Novacek, we've heard again and again today from my fellow colleagues about how there's not been a single taking, a single damaged animal, a single lost animal in all this history of seismic. Can you briefly describe the body of evidence of negative impacts and explain why statements that deny population-level impacts are misleading?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Congressman. Two things I'd like to share. One is there's been some talk about the Gulf of Mexico and the lack of impacts documented in the Gulf of Mexico. And I have with me the numbers, the population estimates for sperm whales in the northern Gulf of Mexico generated by the Fisheries Service. So from 1995, there was a population estimate of 530, and we moved through. That population went to 1,665 individuals in 2007, 8, and 9. And then a 2009 survey before Deepwater Horizon documented only 765 animals in that population. And so all of those numbers come with the caveat from the Fisheries Service that the trend is insufficient to determine a population trend. But nonetheless, we went from 1,665 estimate to 765. I think there's no way we can conclude that there's no impact on this population. And also, we haven't even been shooting seismic in the Gulf of Mexico for the duration of one generation of sperm whales. And so I think that's a very important point. The other one I think it's important to enter into the record was an anecdotal, an observation made by a rather illustrious list of researchers, including James Mead from the Smithsonian Institution, of beaked whales that stranded in the Gulf of California ahead of, in the line of the RV Maurice Ewing, which was the predecessor to the current Lamont Doherty vessel, the Langseth. Those researchers discovered dead beaked whales on the beach in front of that survey, and I will reiterate that this is one observation, but I will also say that science is made up of observations, and our understanding of the impact of naval sonar on marine mammals and causing strandings was also made up of single observations that were then piled up over years. And so we have one observation of animals concomitant with a seismic survey, and I don't think we can discount those. We can't call that gospel, but we should certainly take it into account. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Representative Graves.
Thank you. Dr. Gisner, can you talk a little bit about, listening to all this testimony, the disconnect between some of the allegations coming from certain members of the environmental community as opposed to BOEM on science related to seismic?
I'd say that a lot of what we're hearing from these groups are speculations. One might even dignify some of them as being hypotheses, but they are in the nature of hypotheticals that people are hoping maybe subsequent science will prove them to be correct. But right here and right now, the scientific evidence that we have shows them to be incorrect. Dr. Novacek just mentioned the case of a single stranding of a couple of beaked whales that was attributed through coincidence to a seismic survey, never been repeated. That's what we've got to show for 40 years of seismic survey, whereas sonar-related strandings occur regularly. They're very consistent in their pattern, in their conditions, under their circumstances. That's science. One anecdote is not science.
Thank you. And I want to go back and I'm going to recite William Brown's Chief Environmental Officer for BOEM's quote where he said, assertions are wildly exaggerated and not supported by evidence. You know, that for those of us that do care about the environment and the health of the Gulf of Mexico and the Atlantic, I think looking at measures that will truly ensure the protection of the environment is what is critical. And I had the opportunity to serve as the lead trustee and was very involved in response operations for the Deepwater Horizon spill for a number of years. And seismic wasn't anything that ever came up as being something that threatened the environment or caused problems. It was gross negligence and willful misconduct, as the judge noted. It was a bad cement job, as came out in court, and it was poor decisions in regard to cutting corners related to some of the operations on Macondo that yielded the impacts of the environment. If we end up putting up impediments, the word I used in the last round of questioning is impediments to producing energy in the United States, what happens is we don't have a reduction in demand. We end up having a increase in demand of imports from other countries that simply do not have the same safety regimen in place as we do in the United States. We are some of the safest producers of energy in the world. And I think it's very important to keep in mind that it's going to put additional pressure on some of these other areas that do not have as much respect and concern for the environment as we do have here in the States. Mr. Miller, Mr. White, could you just briefly comment in the last 2 minutes on the how seismic informs decisions? And I'm going to go back to that last question. You know, if you don't have seismic information, you're going to go out there and poke holes all over the place. You're going to be drilling in places you potentially don't have resources or you don't properly know the depth of resources and things along those lines. Could you cite the safety aspects associated with seismic information, please?
Safety in regards to our operation or into the marine mammals?
It's safety related to, you're making a more informed decision on where you're drilling. You're making a more informed decision on what you're bidding in regard to bonus bids for leases. It is information that guides you on what you're doing. I have a bad back and I get spinal injections sometimes. Mm-hmm. The doctor brings in an MRI or X-ray or whatever it is that informs him on where he sticks the needle in my back. And it's a similar situation here. If he didn't have that, I don't want the guy sticking a needle in my spine.
I need your doctor today. But anyway, when we go out and acquire this data on the East Coast, one thing people need to understand is that data goes to BOEM. And BOEM takes that, and they're able to analyze it and help understand the resource base of what we have off the Atlantic. The oil and gas companies use it to bid on leases. And they will bid on leases that they feel are prospective, and they won't bid on ones that are not. And the next phase is that you shoot a 3D, and they will pinpoint a well. It's not going to be like in the 50s and 60s in the Gulf where it was one well off a 2D, one well off another. It's going to be very precise.
I'd like to cite an example, and this happened probably 10, 15 years ago when I was licensing seismic data to an exploration company. They licensed the data. They reviewed it. They refused to pay because they didn't find anything. That in itself tells you that, you know, seismic data brings inherent value whether you drill a well or not, or whether you take a lease or not, okay? And that's what's most important to understand. We provide information, and you made the comment about being informed. The best thing we can do is inform you as regulators, and certainly the agencies like BOEM and certainly the E&P companies. We need to give them as much information to make those informed decisions. And that's what seismic and geophysical data will allow you to do.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Miller and Mr. White, I'm going to ask the last questions here, but I'd like to build on what was begun a second ago. What is potentially at stake here? At some point in time, I believe there will be exploration and possibly production off of the Atlantic. It's like money in the bank, and it's not going to sit idle forever, even if some people cherish that idea. So, Mr. Miller and Mr. White, what is at stake here?
Certainly from our perspective, obviously, again, my thanks to BOEM and Abby for the fact that we've been able to secure our permit to do our non-seismic geophysical exploration off the East Coast. I think that's going to provide with a foundation of information that's going to help guide certainly companies like Ritchie's and the rest of the seismic companies on where to place their seismic, and it certainly is going to give BOEM information. Just as the seismic companies release data to BOEM, we're going to release data to BOEM, and they're going to be able to take that information and decide where they should target the OCS blocks for potential leasing. The impact and what's at stake, I'm from the East Coast. I vacationed on the Outer Banks. I've been there for over 50 years, and probably most people in this room don't realize that a well was drilled at Cape Hatteras in 1947. There was an actual drilling well sitting on the Outer Banks next to the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse. Most people don't realize that, okay? And so exploration has been going on for quite some time, and what drove that to happen was the fact that we just went through World War II. Oil was a big part of our national security at that time, and people realized that you had to explore in other areas that were sensitive. And, you know, there's no remnants that anything occurred in 1947 when that well was drilled. Okay, I don't hear of anything that from an environmental impact that something happened, and you got to figure that the technology in 1947 was a lot worse than the technology that we have today. So the impact is such that we have to open up these areas for exploration, and again, geophysical information is the sound foundation to provide that information to make informed decisions.
What we're looking for is a system that works. We have a permit that's actually two permits that we filed that are in this IHA. We have met with NEMPS about 3 weeks ago. We've reduced our scope by half to try to get this permit approved, which means we'll then have to file another IHA because the BOEM permits are only good for 12 months. So what I don't want to have to do is spend another $1 million on another broken system permit that's going to take a year. It's just like the CZMA process. They laid it out how it worked. You know, it's going to take 30 days for the states to do this. That worked like charm. It's the same group. It's NOAA, and it worked like clockwork. But then you go to NEMPS, and the one question concern I have, a big concern, is the correspondence from NEMPS that says that by the end of December, we will either have or have not denied a permit. So it's the first time we've heard we may not get a permit. So how much longer can our industry keep spending money on these permits? Because every month this goes by, we have consultants working, we have NEMPS ask more questions, we have to get the biologists, we have to pay those.
What just drags on. What possible grounds would they have for turning down?
It's the first time we've seen that. Don't know. I think it's because the scope of these surveys, they say, are so big, they don't fit within the MMPA guidelines. So that's why we worked with them. We reduced the scope to hopefully allow the permit.
Well, I'll repeat. We tried to bring them in to this hearing. They declined to come, said that they didn't have enough time to find a witness. I guess they're so busy processing these permits, they can't spare any manpower. But we will bring them in sooner or later, and we will ask them these questions.
The people doing the work, I think, are doing everything they can.
Okay.
I think it's above them.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just say one more thing. Although we've received our permit, and that's exciting news for us to go out and provide and acquire that information without the knowledge that seismic's going to occur behind it makes that information relatively useless.
Okay. And Director Hopper, I'll just finish up by saying I hope you can work with us to make this convoluted and complex process. And I know you don't have control over NIMFs, but maybe you can talk to them. And let's make this process work better.
I agree. Of course, sir. I will do that.
And then lastly, I would like to say I sure hope, and I know many of my members, and it's fairly bipartisan, want to see the Atlantic or major portions of the Atlantic included in that next five-year plan. So I certainly look forward and hope that materializes. Okay, thank you all for being here. This has been a very educational and informative hearing. The members of the committee may have some additional questions for the witnesses, and I would ask that if you get those, that you would respond to those questions in writing. Under Committee Rule 4H, the hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for these responses. If there's no further business, without objection, the committee stands adjourned.